Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the Morning Wake Up the author of one of the songs that I say haunts me every Sunday because I can't get in the car without hearing it. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome from Building 429, Mr. Jason Roy. Jason, how are you this morning?
Man, I'm doing great. How about you, brother?
I'm good. And like I said, your song Where I Belong haunts me.
Yeah.
There was a point in time where I could not go anywhere without hearing that song.
Yeah, I know. It's kind of crazy. And then, you know, as an artist, you want to have songs like that. And then halfway through the middle of them, you're kind of like, man, I think I'm on everybody's nerves, you know? But, yeah, it's all still special. It's fun to play it every night.
Okay, so how did Building 429 get started?
Man, we were just four guys that didn't have a clue what we were doing. All we knew is that we wanted to go out and play music and, like, you know, share the gospel through our music. We felt like we were talented and had a gift. And so, honestly, we were one of these do-it-yourself bands, you know? I mean, I looked up back in, I guess, 99, 2000 when we started. Google was a brand new website, and we were using Google and searching up, like, you know, Christian coffee houses and clubs and stuff like that. And we would book ourselves state by state, all the way from North Carolina to Alaska, through California, back through Texas, back home, you know? And that's how we got our start. And then along the way, we got connected to a band called Sonic Flood, and we were an independent band. We hadn't even signed a record deal yet, and they invited us to come out and be on their tour. And when that happened, we also wrote a song called Glory Defined, and about the same time both of those things kind of exploded for us. And we signed our record deal in 2003, released Glory Defined in 2004, and have been doing this ever since.
Now, Building 429 is a very unique name. Where did it come from?
Yeah, it comes from Ephesians 4:29 in the Bible. It says, let nothing unwholesome come out of your mouth except that which is helpful for building others up. It's all about the words that you choose to use and being an encouragement. And yeah, my wife came up with that. Like every good idea in my life, that's her.
Okay, now, growing up, you had to get through a bit of a turbulent childhood. And my question is, exactly how did you get through it?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not all on you. I mean, you know, for me, I was surrounded by people who believed in me and saw a gift in me and kept telling me that I was special and had, you know, that there was hope and all that type of stuff. And that helped a lot. And also, I think that, you know, I've heard this said before that all the most successful people in the world are optimists. And that's one of the characteristics that they all pretty much carry together. And I think that for me at a young age, my mom taught me to see the world as, like, you know, you can do anything. You can be anything. You know, like that whole, you could be the president of the United States, Jason, if you want to be. And I said that kind of instilled in me, and that God loved me, and that he had plans for me. And then that whole, he has plans to prosper you and not to do you harm. And I definitely was someone who claimed to that. And it's funny because my mom, when I was five, taught me that scripture, the Lord's not given us a spirit of fear, but of love. And I think that, those kind of scriptures were the things that were written on my heart that helped me. That helped me kind of keep myself together and keep moving forward and believing that somehow God was going to work these things out for good, you know?
So what do you say to the person that may be going through the same kind of difficulties that you've been through?
Yeah, well, I'd say this. I mean, the Word of God, if you study it at all, you begin to recognize that there's not a whole lot of surprises in this life, meaning, you know, one of the scriptures that I keep on my heart all the time right now is that it says, in this life you will face many trials and many sorrows, but take heart, for I have overcome the world, says the Lord Jesus, you know. And it's kind of spelled out, this life is a hard place. Nobody gets a pass. My struggles seem like the biggest struggles in the world, but there are people who have had worse struggles than me, you know. When you transplant yourself to Rwanda in the 90s, then you see people who were actually in the middle of genocide and stuff like that. You know what I mean? And I think that for me, more than anything, what I want people to hear is that God's plans for you are perfect. And when you surrender and submit yourself to his plans, then your life begins to be ordered. For me, a big part of me finally getting my junk together was when I took my parents off of the throne of God. I really honestly equated my mom and my dad with God. You know what I mean? Like these people are godly, and they know all, and they know all scripture, and therefore they are perfect. But the reality is they're people. You know what I mean? And when I finally accepted them for my parents and and recognize that they were going to fail me, just like every other person on the planet will, and put my faith in an unfailing God, the order of my path became a lot more clear, and it got a lot more easy to accept the world for what it is, because again, in the scriptures, it says that this world is messed up, but that Christ is overcome it.
Now, like I said before, I do my research on artists before I interview them. And from what I've, you know, been reading about Building 429, it seems like you guys have been nonstop since the very beginning, you know, with an album release just about every other year and numerous tours.
Yeah, yeah.
So how do you balance your home life with your constantly growing, constantly moving career?
Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. People often ask me that question because of the other thing people don't know, maybe do or don't know. I'm also a worship pastor as well. So when I get home, I'll work there. So I'm on staff at a church. But I think that one of the things that people say is, how do you balance it? And I don't think there is really a balance. I really don't. I think it's more like juggling. You know what I mean? Like in juggling, there's always one ball that's in the air, and you're holding two, and you're throwing them around, and you're just kind of catching one. But you have to focus on what's in your hands, not what's in the air. You know, and I think that for me, I found that the only way that it works for me is when I really do focus on family and try to turn off the band thing. So, you know, when I get home, I try really hard not to be in this world. It's just, you know, it's hard for me, but I try to do that. And then, not to mention that for me also, I kind of hit a point where I was like, I'm not going to lose my family over music. And so my wife, my little girl, is sitting right here on the bus next to me right now. And my wife is sitting right in the front lounge with me, and they travel with me pretty much everywhere I go. So that's how I do it.
Has there ever been a moment where, you know, you felt like it was becoming a little bit too much to handle?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, man. You know, it's not all roses. You know what I mean? And people often ask, like, what's it like to live your life? Well, it's the life that I know. So it's very similar to you going to work every day. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
A high-pressure environment. You have to deliver. You have to get the job done and all that type of stuff. But I thrive here because I love music, because I love ministry, and because I love the guys that I'm on the road doing music and ministry with. You know what I mean? So, yeah, but there are many times when I think it's time to quit and give up and just go home. But again, it's one of those things that God made me just hard-headed enough to make it through those times and stay focused and keep doing what I feel like I'm called to do. And I think that's what separates us from a lot of people who go through hard times and they give up. I feel called to do this. I don't feel like this is what I do because it's fun and this is just my job. I feel like this is what God has ordained me to do. He's gifted me to do, and therefore I'm going to keep doing it even when it's really hard.
And see, that kind of goes right into my next question, which was, you know, what kind of effect has your constantly moving career and work schedule had on your, what kind of effect has that had on your relationship with God?
Yeah, it's definitely created more dependence, you know what I mean? Because, you know, in this life that we do, I mean, we're in a different city every day. We're meeting new people every day. I think there is obviously a truth that, you know, for Building 429, and for me, when I tried to do everything myself is when everything begins to fall apart, you know? And so we've done a really good job surrounding ourselves with amazing people who work hard and who challenge us to be better. And I think that you have to do that. I mean, you have to be surrounded by people who challenge you to be better and who don't accept your mediocre efforts. And I think we've done a good job of that. And I think that our relationships with the Lord continues to grow because we find ourselves being more dependent as the years go on.
Do you find it a little more difficult since, you know, you can't go to church exactly, you know, every Sunday when you're on the road?
Yeah, I do. But at the same time, you know, I mean, I think that when we were younger in our 20s, it was a lot harder, you know, because we were just not quite as grounded. You know, we weren't family men. We didn't have kids and all that type of stuff. Now, we're to an age now where it's not like we have any reason or excuse for not doing what we know we should do. You know what I'm saying? I think that at this age now, I'm the head of my household, father, my husband, been married for 11 years, and it's my responsibility to take care of these things and to stay focused. And so when we get out here on the road, I think that's what you find with everybody in the band specifically, is that all four of us are, you know, we're grown up, we're getting a little older, and it's very hard for us to blame anybody else when it comes to our relationship with the Lord and when it comes to staying grounded to the truth of the gospel.
May of last year, 2011, you guys released your latest album, which is Listen to the Sound. And with this project, it seems like the band is in a different place than with the previous album. So what was the inspiration behind Listen to the Sound and the change in building 429?
Well, man, the first thing is that we changed a new record label, and they kind of, their first thought was that that really all they wanted us to do was just to have fun and make music that we loved and stop making music for a marketplace. And that's what we did. We just made music that we loved. I mean, and in truth, when we made this record, when we were about to make this record, we were kind of just tired. And I was almost done. And so at the end, you know, when you feel like it's over and you're cool, and you kind of, it's okay to throw a Hail Mary, you know what I mean? And I felt like that's what we did. We threw the long bomb and made a record that we liked, not that a market would potentially like. And it turns out when you kind of in surrender make a record that you just in freedom make, it feels like what happens is, you know, it starts connecting with people. And that's exactly what happened. Not to mention the fact that, you know, we made a worship record because I'm a worship pastor. So a large part of this record, we said from the beginning, was if we're going to make a record, let's make a record of songs that people would sing with us, not people that would clap for us at the end of the songs. And that changed everything.
Your latest single, you know, Where I Belong, as I mentioned earlier, that song at one point in time, I felt like it was haunting me because everywhere I went, I heard it. Every time I got in the car, I heard it. Every time I just turned on the radio, period, I heard it. And there was one instance where I heard it in a grocery store.
Oh, nice.
Now, it's starting to become a, in my opinion, a church or like a worship anthem. So did you guys have any idea of the impact that this song would have?
You know, honestly, I think we did. I mean, from the beginning, that song was the one, you know, even when Listening to the Sound, the first single went out, it was a number one CHR song, and it was also, like in the top five on AC Radio, and everybody at the label was kind of high-fiving each other, going, all right, we did it, and we would kind of sit down and say, that's great, but the next song is the big one, and there were many people that were like, oh, yeah, sure, you know, and, it's just really cool, you know, that it did what we actually thought it was going to do. We thought it was. You know, we thought it was going to do that. So, pretty cool.
How does it feel knowing that Where I Belong remained number one on the Billboard Christian Songs chart for 15 weeks in a row?
Yeah, man, it's cool. I mean, you know, you kind of, again, it's one of those things where I think it's funny that the song that's that big is actually a song that you can hear more of my church choir singing than you can me. That's what's so funny to me. You know, the chorus, you hear more of my church choir singing the song than I am, which is perfect because that's the way it should be. You know, it's not about us. And it's so cool to see God use a song and do something spectacular like that.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not where I belong. Take this world and give me Jesus. This is not.
So what does the future hold for building 429? I know you say you were singing every day and recording. So what's building 429's future plan?
Well, we're making a new record right now as we speak. I've been pretty much any day that we're not on the road, we go straight to the studio and work. And so the new record will be out next year. We're making it now. We're going to be doing a Christmas tour with new songs. And then we're going to continue the God's Not Dead tour with Newsboys in the spring. And then we'll do our own headlining tour towards the beginning of summer. So, man, just more than anything, just more of the same, but we're just growing this thing. I mean, I encourage anybody that hasn't seen Building 429 live show lately, man, it's quite a spectacle. So we'll continue to grow, continue to do what we do, and, man, we're excited about what God's doing in us.
Any chance you guys could be coming to South Georgia in the near future?
Oh, yeah, definitely. I mean, there's no doubt that we will be. Just look up our website, facebook.com/building429, and you can look at tour dates, and you can see, or building429.com. I mean, we're in Marietta, Georgia today. There's no way that we're not going to be in South Georgia sometime soon. You know what I mean?
Well, I'm looking forward to it. I'm hoping to see you guys live in person. So is there any, you know, upcoming collaborations on this new project or anybody that you guys would love to work with?
Yeah, actually there is. It's cool. It's a good question. We're actually having Blanca from Group One Crew. She's going to be singing on one of the new songs on the new record. And then my buddy Torin from Royal Taylor is going to be on the record as well. So got some good collaborations going on, and we're on a couple of Christmas songs here and there that are going to be coming out this Christmas. So, man, honestly, we're slamming away. A lot going on real fast, and but that's the way it is. You know what I mean? You got to keep moving.
See, now that's crazy. I talked to Blanca a few weeks ago, and she didn't say anything about that.
That's right. That's right. In fact, I just talked to her yesterday. It's finally confirmed she's going to be on it with us.
Okay. We mentioned upcoming tours and stuff, but anything outside of music coming up?
Outside of music, no. I mean, we're just going to be trying to rest whenever we can. You know what I mean? That's pretty much all we got going on, man. Just music, more music, and ministry, of course. But, yeah, we'll be resting any time in between, that's for sure.
Because, yeah, exactly. You know, some artists like to write books and stuff on the side.
Oh, yeah. Well, I've got my own blog, and I do actually do a lot with it. It's jroymusic.com. Just a way for me to kind of get out my thoughts that I don't have time to get out in a 3.5-minute song. So, yeah, check that out. That'll be something I'll definitely be doing a lot of.
Now, exactly, you know, what is the process for your songwriting? Because I've heard some people say when they write a song, get frustrated, they you know, put it down and come back to it later. Others, you know, to an extent, kind of sit there until the rest of it comes to them and all these different things. So what is your technique for writing a good, solid song?
Well, a solid song starts with a solid idea. You know, if you walk into a songwriting session and all you think about is the grace of God, there's probably been 100 billion songs written about the grace of God. So you better come up with a cool angle on it. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I think that's one of the things that I really don't like doing songwriting sessions unless I have a great idea to start with. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, like for instance, an idea on our new record and a song that I really like that is cool is a song called Best and Worst. And the idea of the song was to write a song that talks about how our best efforts and our worst efforts are always used for the glory of God no matter what. And I wanted to write a song about like that so that those people who feel like they're just struggling and never really doing anything worthwhile would recognize that God's going to use even our worst efforts for His glory and in His master plan. When you have an idea like that, it makes it easy to kind of fill in the gaps and write something that's special. You know what I mean? So, you know, those are the kind of things that we try to go after. Like another song that we worked on for this record, the song called Bonfire. And it's pretty cool because my mom always said to me that I was born to be a flame because I was crazy. You know, I could run around the house like an idiot. And I threw a softball through my window one time because I was just mad at my mom. You know, that's the kind of stuff when I was a kid, you know. And so I thought to myself, well, if I was born to be a flame, then I want to light a bonfire. And that's where the idea for a song called Bonfire came from. So I think an artist's career is all about the song, and the song is all about the idea. So if you don't have an idea, you might as well go home early.
Well, Jason, thank you so much for taking time out of you guys' busy schedule to do this interview. I know you're recording music, you're on tour, you got your family with you, you got a lot going on. But you took time out to do this interview, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah, man, you're very, very welcome. I look forward to seeing you down in South Georgia sometime soon, okay, brother?
All right, we have to talk again whenever the new project comes out.
We'll do it, man.
Or at least the new single.
Sounds good. We'll do it.
All right, well, I appreciate it. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Jason Roy. I am DJ RC. We'll be right back on The Morning Wake Up.
Let's take it. This is the life let's lived. This is where you have placed me, and you want all I have to give. There were times when I was lonely. There were times when I was scared. There were moments when I stopped chasing, and I was frozen in my fear. But I won't be the man who watched the world passing by. I don't really know where this road is going. Me. They said I'd never measure up. All their voices are fading, 'cause I care more about your love. But this is not about them. It isn't even about me, because my worth is found inside your eyes. So I will rise and sing, 'cause I won't be the man.